Hare Krishna. So today we continue the second part of this discussion on the pastime of Sukanya of Sudyumna, who becomes Ila and again keeps changing his gender. This is the first canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, chapter 9. And in the yesterday session, I talked broadly about how the idea of gender being changed by benediction or by sacrifice to have a child of a particular gender, that's not as irrational as we might think it to be. Material nature can be changed in different ways, by raw human effort, by technologically aided human effort, and by religiously aided human effort. And the scriptures describe rationality that is more expansive. So today, I will focus on the theme of when there is this, in this particular story, it is the person changes their gender because of factors beyond their control. That's what happens with Sudyumna in Ila, because the factors beyond his control, the gender keeps changing. But what happens when the gender is something which is changing because of one feels, say, incompatible or uncomfortable with one's own gender, then how is that to be dealt with? First of all, how do we understand it from a philosophical perspective? And then how does one deal with it? That's what we'll try to discuss. So my point is not here to give any definitive answers, but to give basically aids to understanding, because this is an increasing phenomenon in today's world. And the technical word is gender dysphoria, where people feel that the body they identify with is different from the body they have. So let's try to understand from basic level. We understand that our existence is presently three level. There is the spiritual, psychological, and the physical. So the soul is covered by two layers. Broadly, we can say call it the layer of the mind. The mind, of course, includes a subtle body, but it's a shorthand I'm using over here for the subtle body. Now, what happens based on this is that based on the level of being, we have a level of identity. So there is this, now the mind and the body, don't use the word mind and body, but we could say that the soul is our essential identity. That is who we are at our core. Along with that, the body has its physical identity. When there's a newborn baby, there are physical symptoms or physical characteristics by which the gender of the body is determined. So there is a physical identity which comes with the body. And in between, there is the mind. So what one perceives in the mind is one's felt identity. Felt identity, I'll explain what I mean by this. But it is how the mind identifies or what the mind identifies with. So there is a physical identity. And for most of us, this felt identity doesn't come into the picture. But there is an illusory identification in the sense that the soul identifies with the body. But the usual illusory identification is that the felt identity and the physical identity are more or less the same. And they together comprise the bodily identity. The felt identity is what the mind identifies with. Physical identity is what are the biological characteristics of the physical body. And now this bodily identity is different from our essential identity. So usually when we talk about bodily identity, we refer to both the subtle and the gross body together, because both of them more or less identify with the physical body and its characteristics. So I may say I'm a male, I'm an Indian, I'm whatever age group I belong to, whatever other designations I belong to. So they are largely associated with the body. This is the way things usually work. That's how we have our identity. But, and then what is the usual process of self-realization is that we function appropriately as per our body identity while striving to realize our essential identity. That means that we could say this is broadly the system of Varnashram, that each genders have particular roles. The bodily identity doesn't refer just to the gender. Bodily identity also refers to the particular kind of psychophysical nature we have. So there can be Brahmana, Kshatriyas, Vaishya, Shudras. Basically, we function appropriately as per our body identity, and that is at a vyavaharik or a practical level. While at the same time, that's not all that we do while striving to realize our essential identity. So we function externally and then we try to grow internally, to realize internally. So that's the normal way the process of self-realization works. Now, there can be unusual or illusory identification. So what happens in this case is the felt identity is not equal to the physical identity. That means that the person, what their mind feels, that is different from what their body is. The felt identity is different from the physical identity. And then that person has a great sense of existential discomfort. Who am I? So, for example, somebody might be in a male body, but they feel as if they are female. Now, I'll explain this a little bit more in detail. But essentially, when there is gender dysphoria from a spiritual perspective, what exactly is happening is that the mind and the body are at cross purposes with each other. The body is of a particular gender, body is of a particular kind, but the mind conceives or imagines or believes, whatever word we want to use, it to be different. And then that leads to, what is the bodily identity? Here you see the dotted lines, it indicates confusion. Am I, so a person in the male body feels as if I'm a female, or a person in the female body feels I'm a male, then that leads to a lot of social psychological problems for that particular person. So who am I actually? Who am I at a bodily level? That itself is a confusion. So now what is the problem because of this? The problem is, now there are two broad understandings of the nature of the problem also. Is it a matter of degree or is it a matter of category? What do I mean by degree and category? That at one level, everyone feels dissatisfied with the body they have to varying degrees. Now we may feel I'm not slim tall enough, I'm not slim enough, I'm not fair enough. Whatever it is, we feel dissatisfied. So no mind is comfortable or satisfied with the body that it has. Everybody feels like, if only I was this way more, I was that way more, maybe my muscles were stronger, whatever. And so everybody feels this uncomfortable. And we could say that when there is gender dysphoria, that is an extreme in this. Yes, it is extreme, but the essential problem is a matter of degree. But some people think that it's a matter of category. Matter of category is that my problem is utterly different from problems that most people have. I cannot act according to my physical identity. Physical identity means the kind of body that I have. And I must change myself either behaviorally or biologically. So biologically means sometimes people do some surgeries, they either take in some hormones or whatever, so that they try to start acting like the other gender. So there are two visions. Is it a matter of degree or is it a matter of category? The Vedic understanding is that it's a matter of degree. Nobody is fully satisfied with the body they have, but for some people, the dissatisfaction might be extreme. I'll come back later to this point of degree and category. Why does difference matters actually? So moving ahead. So first of all, why such illusory misidentification? That means, you know, there's unusual illusory misidentification. So now for this, we'll have to understand one possible cause could be that there is something called transmigration lag. Just like we might have a jet lag. Now, what is the jet lag? Jet lag is when a person travels from America to India. So that body physically has come to India, but the body's biocycles are functioning as if the person is in America. That's why when it's in daytime in India, the person feels sleepy. When nighttime, the person feels awake. So what has happened is there is a physical relocation, but the functional relocation has not happened. So just as there can be jet lag, there can be a transmigration lag. Let me explain what this means. So let's look at this first to understand this mechanism, how it might happen. So as we know, the soul exists in the body. The soul is surrounded by the mind and the body, as I mentioned earlier. So utkramantam sitam vapi bhunjanam va gunanvitam vimudhananu pashyanti pashyanti yan chakshushah. Krishna says, it is with the eyes of knowledge we can understand how the soul is situated in the body and how the soul departs from the body to go to another body. So now this whole phenomena of why a person might think that, why a male might think I'm a female and a female might think I'm a male, if you don't have this understanding of transmigration, it becomes almost impossible to explain. Let's see how transmigration could be a possible explanation. So normally, how does transmigration occur? The previous body, the physical body, is left behind, and then the soul goes to a new body. So of course, this is not in proportion. The soul is extremely small. The mind is also subtle, but this is simply to indicate that the soul leaves the one body and goes to the other body. And then the soul normally becomes situated in the next body. That's the transmigration is over. So when the soul is situated in this body, when the soul goes into a new body, the soul usually identifies with that body. And when the soul identifies, means what? The mind identifies, basically. The mind identifies with the particular physical body the person has got. But in some cases, what might happen is there's an effect of the transmigration lag. So the soul goes from one body to another body. Here you see there's a thick dotted line here and a thin dotted line here. What it indicates is that the mind still is identifying with the previous body. And the mind has a very relatively loose identification with the present body. And now this transmigration lag. So what has happened is the old body is gone. Now the old body is probably cremated or it's buried or whatever has been done with it. It is no longer existing. And that might not be even the conscious memory of the soul. Of the conscious memory, that means it might not be the conscious memory of the mind, but the mind has that inclination. So a transmigration lag can lead to broadly three different kinds of phenomena. Now, there could be more, but broadly three. First is, there can be past life memories. When a person goes from one life to the next life, normally what happens is, we forget our previous lives. And that is nature's arrangement by which we can start our new life afresh. If at each moment of our life or at critical moments in our life, we started having flashbacks of all our previous lives, it would be very difficult for us to function. And then what to speak of if we had flashbacks of our lives in different bodies, in different species, it would be impossible to function. So generally, when a person leaves the body, they forget that body and they go to the next body. That's the general way nature works. In some cases, some people remember their past lives. Now, usually this happens, not always, but usually or in quite frequently, this happens when the person dies suddenly or unexpectedly. That means that the basically the person doesn't have the time to process the event of death. And then suddenly maybe they are short or they meet with an accident and they die. And then they may go to the next body, but they still keep identifying with the previous body. And children who remember their past lives, they may insist. They will tell a small child may tell the first few words the child speaks. Mom, there are cases of this child says, Mom, where's my other mom? What other mom? And he starts saying very specific things. Okay, you know, this was, I lived here, this was my name, and this was my parents. And quite often when the child is taken to that place, the child leads the person to that place. And then they meet and then they talk. And usually, in this case, what happens is, when there are conscious memories of the previous life, the child goes and meets with the previous parents, and then they get a sense of emotional closure. And it has practically never happened in past life memory studies that once the child meets the previous parents, the child says, oh, I want to live with them. I don't want to live with you. That never happens. The child needs some emotional closure. And even if, say the previous life of the child is much wealthier and in this life, the child is poorer. But still, the child doesn't do that. Child usually has affection for the current parents, but child needs some emotional closure. And researchers did some studies of do the children remember their past lives as they grow older? Say somebody is 60, 70. How much do they remember? So it's like a memory still there. Oh yes, in my childhood, I will remember my past life. But it's a memory without much emotion in it. In the childhood, there's a lot of emotion in it. I have to go and meet them. Oh yeah, I remember. I used to remember that family at that time. That basically, once the emotional closure is got, then the past life memories lose their intensity. That way, that's with respect to past life memories. Now, another thing that can happen because of this is there might be homosexual orientation that might come up, where a person acts sexually as per the previous body, not the present body. And that means that when people enter into particular relationships, then they may, that's how a person in a male body may want, maybe attract, may feel attracted to another male. So, or a person in the female body may be attracted, feel attracted to another female. So what happens is, when a male is attracted to another male, then basically that it is possible that that particular person was a female in their previous body. But now they're attracted to, they have come to a male body. So now specifics can vary. And again, these are, and the whole process of reincarnation, of transmigration, reincarnation is shrouded with mystery. We don't have much clarity, even if we read the scriptures, Upanishads and other places. Garuda Puran talks about a few things, but overall the focus is on the principle of accountability. It is not on the specifics of the journey. That overall principle is we are accountable for our actions, and that's why we have to be careful. The specifics of the journey and the specifics can vary. One more thing that might happen is gender dysphoria. So in homosexual orientation, basically a person just acts according to their, they act sexually, they feel attracted to a person of their particular gender, of the same gender. But in the case of gender dysphoria, the person feels that I just need to change the gender of my body. They feel that this body is incompatible with who I am. And that's why the person feels a need to change their present body. So now these surgeries are quite complicated, they're expensive, and they can be hazardous, but they are being done. And some people feel, after they do that, some people may feel a great sense of relief. Now, the soul can never be at home in the body because the body is temporary, ultimately. At the same time, just as we need a physical home while we are in the world, and we need to feel at home in our physical home. Similarly, the soul needs to feel at least somewhat at home in its bodily home. That means feel comfortable. So now, having said this, if we look at it, I talked about one possible explanation for this. But beyond that, when there are non-standard sexual orientations, non-binary, that means not just a person, is not just basically apart from the what is called a straight. So how might it happen? So one way of looking at it is, the pure, completely spiritual way is that actually we are neither homosexuals nor heterosexuals. We are souls. Like our sexuality has to have nothing to do with our identity. That's what we discussed yesterday. So whether it is standard sexual orientation or non-standard sexual orientation, there's actually nothing to do with who we are, which is okay. And there is the other extreme, which often arises from materialism, and not just from materialism, but where people think this is who I am. So my sexual orientation defines who I am. Now, in between is that, okay, who I am, that is a significant part of who we are presently. And how significant, that may vary from person to person. So for example, somebody might be, now for many people, even if they are not very spiritual, not for many, for some people, even if they're not very spiritual, if they're not too much in the mode of passion, if they're in the mode of goodness, then their sexuality is not a major part of their life. Yes, it's a part of their life, but that's not what consumes their mind constantly. And for people in the modes of passion and ignorance, that sexuality consumes them completely. So just as that can happen for people with standard sexual orientation, it can happen for people with non-standard sexual orientation also. That means there are some people who may be gay, but there are some people who are not just gay, but they are gay activists. That means, okay, a person who is, what is the difference between a gay and a gay activist? A person who is a gay may say that, who is a gay person may say that, okay, I am similar to everyone else in all aspects except one. And accept who I am and let's move on with life. And the person who is a gay activist, they hold that, you know, I am different from my sexual orientation difference is the foundation of difference about everything. And all societal structures need to be changed, need to be disrupted, need to be brought down for this purpose. So what does it mean? It means that now, so people say that I will be gay, but we will have children. Now, biologically, a gay couple can't have a child. Say, no, we will do something. We will have some means and we will have our own children. Okay. And you raise your children and then they'll be aggressive. Actually, we can raise our children better than what straight parents can. And therefore, straight marriages, straight parenting, all that is not considered to be standard. There's no such thing as a standard. So this becomes quite disruptive. So basically, the non-standard sexual orientation, the philosophical understanding is that, yes, our sexuality is a part of who we are. And how important a part? It depends on individual level of consciousness. Is that person in goodness, passion, or ignorance? Depending on with the mode we are in, it will affect us to that extent. So now if you move further, so how are the non-standard sexual orientations, if somebody has that, how is that to be dealt with? Or what does one do with it? So there have been different approaches traditionally. So basically, the contemporary usage, it's a software issue. Software issue means, if you consider the body is the hardware, the mind is the software. The software issue means it's all in the mind. You just change yourself. It is changeable by treatment and training. Just take some treatment, do some training, and you'll forget all this. And you will just become like a straight person. So in most traditional societies, this was treated as a software issue. Traditional societies means, I'm not just talking about like an institution, but in culture of the societies. So for example, up to 2-3 decades ago, this was treated as a software issue. And therefore it was thought that you'll treat and you'll cure it. But now the mainstream opinion has changed where it is largely seen as a hardware issue. Hardware issue means this is the way I am born. This is the way I am. It is impossible to change. And not only is it impossible to change, so what this means is that this is the way I am and this is the way I will live. So what has happened? The mainstream opinion, say for example, 20-30 years ago, the way society was that homosexual unions, say homosexual marriages, were considered illegal. Now the situation has gone to the other extreme. But not only are homosexual marriages, at least in America and several other parts of the Western world, not only are homosexual marriages considered legal, but beyond that, it has gone to the level that anybody who doesn't accept those marriages, that person is considered to be a fanatic. So for example, you know, so there have been cases, the cases are going on in the US courts right now. Most of the cases get litigated or they get adjudicated in a way that favors the homosexual. So for example, there might be, so Christians considered homosexuality, at least not Christians, is a very, very broad community. There are many denominations and many variations within their opinions, but broadly mainstream Christianity considers, you know, although Christianity accepts the soul, they consider the soul and body to be non-separable. And their idea is that just as Jesus was resurrected, that means Jesus came back in the same body and he ascended to heaven. That's what their understanding is. So similarly, their idea is we will all be resurrected. So that means we will arise in the same body and we'll go to heaven. And that's how we will live in heaven. So although they accept the soul and the body in their conception is non-separable. And therefore, the idea that that a person's soul and the body are different because that idea is not there. So they think that homosexuality is somehow it's like a it's a devilish deviation from the norm. And therefore, say now some Christian cake makers, wedding cake makers, they may say that, no, we will not make cakes for a gay marriage. And they have been, when somebody refuses to do that, they have been severely fined and their businesses have been shut down. They say, how can you be so intolerant? So whereas it was considered to be, homosexuality was considered to be questionable, at least in the past, now it is questioning homosexuality is objectionable. So the tide of the social opinion has changed largely. And one reason why it has changed is that many homosexuals came out with their stories of, you know, how they lived in fear, how they were persecuted, how they were discriminated. And when there are many accounts of these in the mainstream media and the mainstream culture, books have been written. So when people hear these stories, they start thinking that, you know, if a person has to go through all these emotional trouble, their fear and bullying and discrimination, why would anyone go through this if it was changeable? Why would anyone go through this if it is changeable? So therefore, their understanding is it's not changeable. So whereas in the past, it was thought to be a software issue, now it is thought to be a hardware issue. And so hardware issue means if you can't control it, then it is unfair for society to judge you. Somebody may be born in a particular race and people shouldn't be discriminated based on their skin color, because that they can't control it from this life's perspective. So similarly, if somebody can't control it just the way they are born, then they should not be judged for it. So that's the pendulum has shifted from it be considered a software issue to a hardware issue. And what is the reality? Now the reality is complicated, that it's a complex blend of variable blend of hardware and software issues. Why is it like that? I'll explain that in the next slide. But broadly, now there are cases, few cases of say somebody who had homosexual inclinations and then they got married to they had a heterosexual marriage and they transcended their homosexuality. And there are many cases of people who didn't do that. So in today's media, the first kind of cases are, in the past 20, 30 years ago, the first kind of cases were highlighted as this is a treatment for everyone. But in today's media, those kind of cases are almost completely sidelined and banned. And no, it's not possible to change. But the reality is the soul's embodiment in the body itself is very complex. So when there is a non-standard sexual orientation, the individual and the society, let them work things out pragmatically, whatever it works out. So there is no need to condemn, there is no need to champion. So one extreme is condemn it's bad. Why are you doing like this? The other is to champion it. This is my birthright and how dare you infringe on it? How dare you criticize it? So the point is that we don't have to condemn it, we don't have to champion it. We have to work with it. So I'll explain what I mean by work with it. So when we talk about individual non-standard sexual orientation, so what does it mean? That means when an individual, say, either has a homosexual orientation or an individual feels that, no, I am not this gender, I am something different. So a male feels I am a female or a female feels I am a male. So what might be the cause of it? So again, there is one extreme, the other extreme. So one extreme is, if you consider it was acquired entirely as an inborn tendency, it is acquired entirely out of desire or fashion. And in between, again, it is a complex blend of both. Now, what do I mean by this? That acquired entirely as an inborn tendency? Yes, it's possible. Like we discussed, why, because of transmigration lag, it might be that a person may have either a non-sexual sexual orientation, or they may feel that they don't belong to the gender of their body. It's possible. But is that the case in every person who has this situation, who professes to be like that? Not necessarily. Why not necessarily? Because, say, it could be that when some particular way of living becomes becomes cool, more people may want to explore it. So there is also beyond this something called bisexual, where people engage in sexuality with people of both genders. So what is happening is, it could be because of now this possibility is also there. And as as non-standard sex, this becomes more and more probable. It becomes possible, it becomes probable. So in youth or throughout one life, people explore their sexuality. They want to enjoy sexual pleasures. And sometimes it may happen that, or quite often it happens that sexual pleasure doesn't live up to the anticipation. There is pleasure, but it is very tiny as compared to what the mind imagines it to be. And some people may think, because I'm not just exploring the pleasure in the right way. So because of that, people may have many sexual partners. But not only they may have many sexual partners, they may also explore sexuality in different ways. So now I'm not saying that this is the way it is for everyone. It is, how is it for each individual? That may vary. So that may vary depending on, it's very difficult to know in advance, know externally. It may be difficult for a person to know internally also. The way with respect to gender dysphoria, the situation in today's world is that there was this case in Canada where a couple were separated and the boy was staying with the girl. Boy was staying with his mother. And the mother saw that this boy, small boy, maybe 6 years old, 7 years old boy, he liked to cross-dress. Cross-dress means that a boy dresses like a girl or a girl dresses like a boy. So based on that and some other experiences and after consulting a psychologist or whatever, the mother decided that that actually my boy is a girl. He's not a boy, he's a girl. And at that age, 6 or 7, they decided to talk with the boy and they said yes. And then the boy decided to go through some surgical procedures to change his gender. Or the mother decided for the boy. And the father opposed. And when the father opposed to this, the result of that was, so it is, if a person says that I'm not a boy, I'm a girl, and then it is considered not just politically correct to refer to them by their particular preferred gender, but it is considered almost in today's society uncivilized or even illegal to refer to them by a gender different from what they prefer. So the father said that, no, you are a boy, you're not a girl. And then that led to a huge court case. The mother said that this father is psychologically damaging to the child's self-esteem. And eventually the father was fined an astronomical amount and all visitation rights were taken away from the father. So now this is not an anomalous case. It is an extreme case. It is a case, but it is not anomalous. So now what has also happened is, for example, transgender, where a person changes one's gender. So what has happened, there are a significant number of, say, boys say maybe teenagers or young men, they do transgender surgery and then they change their gender and they become females. And then they participate in female athletic events and they still have the body of a male. And they just easily defeat all the females. So a girl might be training for a sprint or marathon. Among all the girls, she could be a champion, but just some boys change their gender and they become girls and they become champions. They become champ. Now, this becomes very unfair for the girls, for the females. But when somebody speaks against them, transgender or trans boys who have become girls, they should not be allowed to participate in girl competitions. So this is treated as transphobia. That how dare you say that they are not girls? How dare they should not be participating? And anybody who criticizes this, they are severely condemned. There is a cancel culture in today's society where some people can get so condemned on social media that they get practically cancelled. Their social media gets blocked or they get overwhelmed. So there are some tennis champions who were legends in tennis. They spoke against this boys who have become girls playing girls tennis and defeating all the girls. And they were practically cancelled. They were condemned severely. So when I say it is probably adopted entirely out of desire of fashion, but we don't know. Did the boys do it like that just so that they could win the girls' competition? Maybe, maybe not. But the result is that it is complicated. The result is that it is being unfair for the girls. That's why the balance would be, it's we can't say it's entirely out of fashion. We can't always say it's entirely an inborn tendency. Whatever it is, it's a complex situation which society has to navigate. The individual and the society have to navigate pragmatically. So now all this is, the sociological aspect of it is extremely complex. And still society is negotiating with it. So at one level, if somebody is of a particular gender orientation and they want to live that way, yes, whether that has to be stopped? No, we live in a democratic society. That society can't stop an individual from living that way, the way they want. But to accommodate them, how much should society be changed? How much should society be redefined? Social structures be redefined? That is something which is very complicated. Now, how does all this apply for us who are on the spiritual path? See, the broad principle on the spiritual path is that manage sexual energy so that it doesn't impede spiritual growth. That sexual energy can be, it's a very powerful energy and it can be the greatest distractor on the spiritual path. So that sexual energy has to be managed. And how is that to be managed? So traditionally, there are the four varnas and people would go through the training phase of celibacy. And whether it was specifically in ashram or whether for girls, it was at their homes with chastity. Then after that, there is the grihastha ashram, where there is a marriage. Now, when you talk about marriage, here we are talking about heterosexual marriage. But the principle is that manage sexual energy so that it doesn't impede spiritual growth. Now, how is that principle to be applied in today's world? Now, it could be. Now, it's definitely true that as compared to, say, 50 or 100 years ago, the number of people who seem to be either homosexual or gender dysphoric or transgender, they seem to be substantially more than in the past. Even the past 100 years ago or several hundred years ago, definitely. Now, it could be that in the past, there were many people and they all lived in fear and never came out. Or it could also be that we understand from the characters of Kali Yuga is upadrutaha, the mind is constantly disturbed. And there are various causes for the disturbance of the mind. So one cause of the disturbance of the mind could be that the souls are experiencing more transmigration lag, not identifying with the body that they have. And that's creating conflict in their lives. So what would be the way ahead? This is the conclusion. See, there is a spiritual purpose and there's a traditional method to achieve that spiritual purpose. So for example, now the traditional method or spiritual purpose was that sexual energy should not interfere with spiritual growth. And the traditional method for that was heterosexual marriage. That is helpful for most of humanity. That's how humanity has lived and humanity has survived and reproduced and has continued on for millions of years now. Now, if the traditional method, say of heterosexual marriage, is imposed on people without any knowledge of without feel extremely repressive. Now, why should I do this? I just don't. I don't want to do this. And that will create problems. On the other hand, if there is no spiritual purpose and there is no traditional pattern, then what will happen? People's spirituality will completely be consumed by their sexuality. That means there will be etam drishti mavashtabhya nashtatmano alpabuddhaya. Ashtatmano, the soul will be destroyed. So people will become so consumed by their sexuality that they'll completely forget life's spiritual dimension. And the last could be that for some people, they want to pursue a spiritual purpose, but the traditional method, that is heterosexual marriage, may not work for them. So what is to be done? Needs careful, honest deliberation. Or for that matter, somebody is a transgender. Somebody has that gender dysphoria where they feel, I don't belong to this gender. So now, is it because of fashion or desire? Careful and honest deliberation. So we as a movement have not really tackled this issue adequately. And overall, everybody has to be encouraged to grow spiritually. Now, how can they grow spiritually? I'll conclude with this metaphor that say somebody is in the ocean. And when we are in the ocean, we feel that the part of the ocean where I am in is very stormy. And that part looks very calm. So somebody who is of a particular orientation, somebody is of a homosexual orientation, they live in a society where that kind of behavior is not accepted. They may feel, oh, only if I go to a society where it will be there, it'll be so peaceful. Or if belong to this gender, so then they may feel, oh, this part of the ocean is very violent, it's very disturbing, that part of the ocean is much more peaceful, I just want to get there. Well, fine, if we get there, we'll find that part of the ocean will also become disturbing. The ocean is never peaceful. So the point is not whether this part of the ocean is good or that part of the ocean is good. We want to get out of the ocean. We want to catch hold of the rope of Krishna's mercy. Tesham aham samuddharta mrityu samsara sagarat bhavami na chirat partha mai aveshit chetasam. Krishna says that if somebody becomes devoted to me, then they can be pulled. I will pull them out soon out of material existence. So if somebody can be in this part of the ocean, they catch the rope from here and they go up, that's fine. If somebody says, I need to go to that part of the ocean and from there I'll catch the rope, there is no need to force them to stay over here. You have to be here only and you have to catch the rope from here. Okay, you go there and catch the rope from there. But the point is, if somebody thinks, I just can just get to that part of the ocean and all my problems will be solved, my life will be happy. No, that's not going to happen. So we don't have to condemn somebody who wants to go to that part of the ocean. That's what I said. And nor does somebody who wants to go to that part of the ocean needs to champion that. Oh, if only you allow that, all the problems of life will be solved. No condemning. There's no need to no condemning, no championing. It's just we have to manage in life. In material existence, for most problems, there are no perfect solutions. There are only, we could say, tolerable trade-offs. So, okay, what is the trade-off that we need to have as an individual, as a society, as a broader culture, human culture? That is something which needs to be negotiated. But understanding our overall spiritual, understanding the philosophy of Bhagavad Gita, understanding the principles of bhakti can help us to find a way out of this very confusing and increasingly affecting some segments of society. So ultimately, it is spiritual consciousness that has to be cultivated, and therein is the solution to all problems, whether they arise from heterosexuality or homosexuality, whether they arise from standard sexual orientations or non-standard sexual orientations. Ultimately, it is spiritual orientation that is the solution, and how individuals can develop their spiritual orientation, that is something which will have to be liberated through care and honesty, and then the way ahead can be found. So I'll summarize. I spoke today on the topic how non-standard sexual orientations and the things associated with that can be understood philosophically and dealt with practically in the light of the philosophy. So first I talked about how when somebody identifies, when somebody feels, so normally the soul, we have three levels of existence, body, mind, and soul. And accordingly, there is this essential spirit. Physical identity. For most people, the mind and the body, they go together. So their felt identity and their physical identity becomes their bodily identity. And the soul, when it goes from one body to another, the soul identifies with the next body. But for some people, it may happen that they identify with the previous body, not the present body. And that can happen because of a transmigration lag. And transmigration lag may lead to either past life memories, which usually are dealt with by emotional closure, or it may lead to, say, non-standard sexual orientations, which may be, which is where a person doesn't identify with the sexual, doesn't identify, feel attracted to a person of the same sexual, same gender. And there could be gender dysphoria, where a person feels that my body's gender is not actually my gender. So now, how does one approach the situation? There are one extreme is to think that this has nothing to do with who I am. The other extreme is to think this is who I am. The central part is that may depend on the person's how much they are in, which mode they are in. Just as for heterosexual people, also sexuality is a variable part of their life. Similarly, for it may be for others also. And then, so in the past, even 20, 30 years ago, this was largely seen to be a software issue. That means it's just in the mind and it was thought to be treatable by training or treatment. But now it has moved to largely a, seen as a hardware issue. That it is something which people are born with and they should not be judged against. It could be inborn or it could also be a, something which is out, adopted out of a desire or fashion. So there has to be introspection. There has to be consultation. And then there has, the society itself can be very complicated mess. And we see that, I gave some examples of how the complexities are coming up in society. So the solution discusses how the principle is that sexual energy has to be managed so that spiritual growth can be pursued. And that is heterosexual marriage. Now that if it is imposed for somebody who doesn't have a spiritual purpose, they'll find it repressive, even if they have standard sexual orientation. What to speak of somebody has non-standard sexual orientation. And if somebody neither has spiritual purpose, then their sexuality will be consumed by their spirituality. And if they have a non-standard sexual orientation and they have a spiritual purpose, then through honest consultation and introspection, and the underlying principle is that ultimately it's not a difference of category, it's a difference of degree. Material existence is not a, or bodily identity is not a happy place for, happy situation for anyone. So whether I'm in this part of the ocean and I want to go to that part of the ocean is not important. How best can I get out of the ocean? If I can get out of the ocean from where I am right now, excellent. Catch the whole of Krishna's mercy and get out. If somebody needs to go that part of the ocean, in that. It just has something has to be dealt with functionally and ultimately take shelter of Krishna's mercy. So the sexual orientation issues should not obstruct people in developing and in developing their spiritual orientation. Because ultimately it is spiritualization of consciousness that is going to solve all problems. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hi Krishna, thank you so much, Chidanshan Prabhu. I'm sure there will be a lot of questions on this topic. Thank you for presenting such a sensitive topic with a thorough detailing and compassion and sensitivity. Thank you so much. So I would like to invite devotees at this point of time, if depending on how much time Prabhu has, you can have some questions if there are.
Not a question, Chaitanya Charan Prabhu, but a comment. Yashoda Dulal Das. Yashwirarika and I really enjoyed the class, and you know, we thought you did an excellent job presenting on a topic which most of us probably get confused in or tangled in. So really, really from the bottom of our hearts, thank you for elaborating so nicely and so sensitively.
Thank you, Prabhu. You know, it's a very difficult topic, and I have also battled over trying to understand it myself and explain it, because ultimately, kind words. Yes.
Oh, I see some raised hand. Lumi, if you would like to ask a question.
Yes, I have a question. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
So my question is, for what advice would you give if someone is asking who has a non-standard sexual orientation when they are married to like a gay partner and they're wanting to develop themselves spiritually? I guess from an article that I was reading about this, it said that from our movement's perspective, we're not so concerned with someone's sexual orientation. We're more concerned with sexual activity. And like you said, we're supposed to be managing the sexual energy so it doesn't impede with spiritual growth. So in the Shastras, it says that if you're a heterosexual, the way to manage our sexual energy would be to get in a heterosexual marriage and then have children or have sex only for procreating Krishna conscious children. However, since gay marriage cannot produce biologically children, would we give the advice that, okay, if a gay person wants to, you know, increase their spirituality, they would have to be celibate basically and adopt children if they wanted to foster, you know, Krishna conscious children. So they would have to basically be celibate for the rest of their life. And I think that is where the big rift would come, is because people don't want to be celibate. Yeah. They want to express love with their partner, even if it is moderated.
Yeah, this is a difficult situation. If somebody is in a gay relationship, they're married already and they want to grow spiritually. So how do they deal with, say, the principle of union for procreation? Now, what that union for procreation is an ideal. We aspire for it. And spirituality is rarely a 1-0 kind of issue, where you know that if you can't do this, then everything else apart from this is zero. If we consider the 12th chapter, Krishna talks about pure devotional service in 12.8, and he says, if you can't spontaneously fix your mind on me, then you strive conscientiously to fix your mind on me. That is sadhana bhakti. If you can't do that, then you work for me. That's 12.10. If you can't do that also, then you just cultivate selflessness, work for some good cause. So the idea is that there could be various levels between 1 and 0. So spirituality is not a digital, it is analog. And in some ways, for various, now sex, of course, sexuality is a great force, just in the sense that how it can captivate people, also in the sense it's a great force, also in the sense that it has the capacity to bring new life into the world. So it has to be managed carefully. So in one sense, sexuality is different from all other human activities because people may do for it and what people can do through it, and they can bring new life. Having said that, another way of looking at it, it is a biological function. So if we compare it, now this comparison is not entirely accurate. Every comparison has limitations, but just for understanding, if we compare it to another biological function, say like eating. Now with respect to food, there can be various levels of purity in the food we eat. know, we can have, say, the highest level of food would be that something which is the agriculture is done by devotees, which is harvested by devotees, which is cooked by devotees, offered by devotees, and it is honored by devotees. So we could say that's the highest level of food. That's the highest level of food that we can take, the purest level of eating. Below that, you could have various levels. We can cook food from wherever it is harvested. We cook it, we offer it to Krishna, and then we take it. There could be lower levels where, you know, we may get, some people get food from outside, and then they offer it, Krishna, and they take it. Some people may go to some social occasions where they may not even be able to offer the food physically. They might just offer it in the mind and take it. So now there are various degrees. But suppose somebody says, I'll take non-vegetarian food. Well, that is a no. That can't be done. That's something which you have to avoid. So we could say that there is a continuum of various levels of purity in the food that we eat. And there are some limits which transgressing them would be very serious. So similarly, we could say with respect to sexual activity also, there could be various levels in it. So a sexual union only for the purpose of procreation is the highest level, is the ideal level. Now, below that, there could be various levels. But if somebody starts having sexual activity outside the boundaries of marriage, that would be something we could compare it to, say, non-vegetarian food. So that is something which is quite a serious thing. It is not just disruptive for that person's spirituality. That can be disruptive. It is often disruptive for the family and for the society at large. So there will be degrees, and this applies whether it is for, say, heterosexual activity or homosexual activity. So we need to recognize that while we strive for the ideal, we don't have to consider ourselves disqualified just because we are not at the ideal. There's a phrase in English, like retire upstairs. Retire upstairs means that, oh, that is the ideal, but it is completely impractical. So I just forget it completely. So we strive for it. But it's not that a person has to consider themselves disqualified from bhakti because of not being able to follow it. And it's not that a person has to live under a crushing burden of guilt because they're not able to follow it. In bhakti, we are never qualified, but we are never disqualified either. Now, we are all unqualified, but not disqualified. Unqualified means none. Who among us can say that I have the purity of heart by which I can approach the all pure divine, all pure Krishna, who performs loving pastimes with his pure devotees? Very few of us can say that. So we are all, in one sense, unqualified. But it is Krishna's mercy because of which we are never disqualified. So unqualified means I don't have the necessary qualification to be here. Disqualified means I'm not allowed to be here. So Krishna's mercy is such that one is never disqualified from the practice of bhakti. So once sexual activity is at one level a very personal and private activity, so we strive to move toward the ideal. But at the same time, it doesn't have to be that just because the ideal is not there, we don't just simply relegate the ideal to the impractical. But at the same time, we don't burden ourselves with guilt and feelings of condemnation because we are not at the level of ideal. So that would be my broad understanding of how to deal with such situations. Okay.
Hi, Krishna Prabhu. Thank you so much. Lumi, you want to add something or before we take the next question?
Thank you, Prabhu, for your answer. And I guess from listening to your answer, if someone asked me my advice, like, what do you think as a Hare Krishna on this subject? I guess I would tell them, okay, well, if you are choosing to have a non-standard sexual orientation, then it would be better if you were married, since I guess gay marriage is allowed now. I don't know if it's allowed in the whole United States or not, but it would be better to, if you can't be married, but just be in a monogamous type relationship. And as you increase your service to Krishna, then your desire for sexual activity will decrease for everyone.
Yes. Thank you. Well said.
Okay. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
There's another question from Mother Angelica. You'd like, means, do you have the time to take it, Prabhu?
Yes.
Okay. Angelica.
Thank you. My question is related to preaching and gender, because during your class, you mentioned how, like, the idea of pronouns as well, how, you know, there are the kind of assumed body pronouns that we are almost born with, right? Like female body, she, her, and male body, he, his. Yeah. And then there are the in-betweens that people would prefer and feel comfortable with. And so, you know, putting aside even like our personal judgments and opinions of like what's right and what's wrong, how do we approach it in preaching? Because I feel like for me, I'm trying my best to just make someone comfortable. And even if it can be like a take or break situation, if someone, you know, prefers theirs pronouns or like, you know, is transgender and we don't address them by the right pronoun, they may never come back and they may just be completely put off for their entire life and never take to Krishna consciousness. So yeah, I just want to hear about like your opinion on this boundary, in a sense, like sometimes even foregoing our own ideals just to like make someone comfortable and where to draw that balance.
Yeah. This is whether to address people by their preferred pronouns. This is a polarizing issue even in mainstream society. Although, of course, as I said, in some ways, at least with respect to the mainstream media and culture, the battle has been won by the homosexuals, by the transgenders, where in some places, legally you can be punished if somebody doesn't address a person by the preferred gender. So with respect to this, in my understanding, we are all in uncharted territory. You know, we are in uncharted, as a tradition. And it's not just a Krishna conscious tradition. I would say most religions in the world today are in uncharted territory. And because of being in uncharted territory, how exactly to deal with particular situations is something which is quite difficult to discern. So at least initially, our purpose needs to be that we don't make things more difficult than necessary for people to come to Krishna. So if that means adopting the particular gender that they prefer, well, okay, I don't see any major harm in that. Now, whether are we standardizing or are we accepting them in that sense? Well, the way we address people varies. Say, for example, within with nomenclature, how important is it? That depends, or that depends on person to person, depends on whom you ask. So, for example, you know, we may refer to each other in the devotee community as Prabhu and Mataji. But sometimes when we are dealing with each other, and we may, especially if we are in among new people, we may not use those particular honorifics with particular people or in front of particular people. Or to speak of our names, sometimes our names can also be so complicated for those from a non-Indian background. We even shorten the names and use shorter names. So I think nomenclature is not so. Similarly, I would say the same applies to the gender, that we as a individual have to take the judgment call. And generally, if we associate with senior devotees who are experienced and we learn from them, we also will be able to make out, you know, what is essential and what is peripheral. So what is essential needs to be held on to. So what is peripheral, that can be adjusted. And by if holding on to the insisting on the peripheral is, as you said, going to alienate people and that is going to make them hostile to the essential, then we may be doing a disservice. Normally, we as devotees greet each other as Hare, by saying Hare Krishna. I've been told by several Prabhupada disciples that when Prabhupada would go to morning walks, especially in Western countries, often he would greet people as good morning. If somebody would greet him, it would be good morning. That's just simple courtesy. So now, when we go from simple courtesy to, say, caving into the contemporary cultural norms or contemporary cultural demands, that some people may think it's a slippery slope, and if they start on this, then you will go down to that. Well, it doesn't have to be like that. If we ourselves are clear what is central and what is peripheral, then certain things we can adopt according to whatever makes the other person more comfortable. And then we move on from there. Now, there will be, of course, certain things which are not to be changed. So for example, even with respect to with Krishna, when you're talking with new people, we may not use the word Krishna, we may use the word God, or we may use the word divine, we may use the word ultimate reality. But then if we are giving a Bhagavatam class in the temple, that time we shouldn't be using those words. When we can use the word Krishna, and when the occasion requires us to use the word Krishna. So it depends on context a lot. So the principle is what is essential has to be held on to, and what is the peripheral can be adjusted. But if we are not careful, then in adjusting the peripheral, we may gradually start thinking of the essential is also peripheral. And then we will become, this is a whole topic in itself about how to speak effectively. So it is that we should not be afraid to speak unpalatable truths if they are necessary. But we shouldn't necessarily think that truth always has to be unpalatable. That if, say, this is a whole circle of truth, and from that I can present a palatable part to this person so that they get attracted toward Krishna. And yes, for all of us, even for us, we are practicing bhakti right now. We can't say all the truths of Krishna consciousness are palatable for us. Some of them may be unpalatable for us, and we may have to digest them also. But then there are also palatable truths which we digest, and then that helps us to balance. So in principle, we don't have to think that to speak the truth, I have to speak unpalatably all the time. Nor do I think that I should never speak unpalatably because people will go away. Sometimes we may have to speak some truth because of which some people may find it unpalatable and they may go away. But is that truth essential for that person to grow at that particular point? If it is not, then okay. And there is no need to insist on it at that particular point. Srila Prabhupada, when he was in India, he was working with many life members, and they helped him. These were people who helped him enormously in building temples and expanding the movement in India. But most of these life members were actually they were already connected with some other spiritual teachers. Many of them were initiated and prominent disciples of other spiritual teachers. When Prabhupada went to their houses, they would often have big pictures of their spiritual masters, and most of them were Advaitins, were impersonalists. Now, Prabhupada did not make it an issue to challenge them. They had been decades with that particular spiritual teacher. Maybe for dynasties or for generations, their family was connected with that particular spiritual tradition. So Prabhupada did not confront them over there. Prabhupada engaged them in Krishna's service. So now, of course, Prabhupada had his books in which he talked about impersonalism, and he did point out the problems with that. But context is important. So context sensitivity is not compromising. Context sensitivity is actually compassion. Does it answer your question?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.